Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
I'm told that we've broken a record at the Council on Foreign Relations. This is the longest period a group has waited for an esteemed speaker. So I think that tells us something about our guest today. So first of all, let me welcome everyone to today's Council on Foreign Relations meeting. A quick reminder for everyone, please turn off your cell phones, not just put it on vibrate, but turn it off completely. It will interfere with the sound system. And this meeting is officially on the record. Today our speaker is Vladimir Yakunin. For those who aren't familiar with him, he is the president of state-run company Russian Railways. So he really is the guy who makes the trains run on time.
Unlike the traffic here. You know.
Yeah, that's right. I'm sorry we can't do something about our airline system here, so you'd be... Yeah. But he is a former first secretary of the Soviet Permanent Rep Office to the United Nations. He's a former deputy minister of transportation. He's a close associate of Prime Minister Vladimir Putin's and considered to be one of Russia's really true insiders. So we will have the opportunity, we'll have a slightly abbreviated session with Mr. Yakunin. It'll be approximately 45 minutes. For those who need to leave, feel free. We understand it's the session is longer. But we've asked to have Mr. Yakunin start with a brief 5 minutes or so of remarks. After that, we'll do a short conversation and then open it up to our members for a Q&A. Mr. Yakunin, welcome. Sorry about the weather, the traffic, everything else, but glad you made it.
I suppose I consumed these 5 minutes just to bring my deepest apologies to you, ladies and gentlemen. And it was not due to my negligence, but due to the factor of weather, because we were stuck in Washington for quite a time waiting the permission to start. And, you know, then the traffic in New York City did not improve since I left the city. And so please accept our apologies for this delay. I know that is very tough just to wait somebody, but because we waited us, you know, whatever questions you have, we will answer at our best knowledge, of course. And I am very glad to see my friends here. Some of them we met not quite long ago, but it is my first visit to New York City since 19 years ago.
Really?
Yes, I was in Washington, but, you know, I did not have any chance and need to come to New York City. So for me, it is kind of reunion with the place I left 19 years ago. So that is the remarks, and then I would like you to consider me with three fields of interest where I can answer maybe professionally some questions. The first field, this is, of course, the development of infrastructure. And, you know, the development of economy in Russia through the prism of infrastructural projects. Second field, that is our public work, and I have here some of my friends who are closely associated with this work, Secretary General of World Public Forum Dialogue of Civilization, Mr. Atkov, you know, and a member of the parliament and very influential party member, Mr. Pligin is here also. Alisev, Mr. Alisev is our close associate, and he is an active figure in our public activities, both World Public Forum and the Foundation of Andrew the First Call and National Glory. This is public side. And some of, you know, expert and scientific side, because I have small research center dealing with the governance aspects, not only in Russia, but, you know, entirely, globally. So that, more or less, the fields I can feel myself professional, more or less. Thank you.
Good. So why don't we start with a few questions for Mr. Yakunin. First, can you tell us how things look for Russia's economic recovery right now? First, from the point of view of Russian Railways as a company, and second, from the economy as a whole.
Much better than the weather in New York City and Washington, trust me. Listen, in the spring, I visited Brookings University, and my old friend Fiona Hill asked the question, can you tell us what are the roots of the crisis and how to get out of this crisis? And that was funny. I asked, listen, this is your crisis, and you're asking me for prescriptions. So it was friendly remarks and telling the truth. Since the beginning of the crisis, many officials in Russia, they did not believe that the crisis would hit the economy of Russian Federation. That was strange, but that was fact.
At the famous island of stability.
That yep. was, yes. And, you know, possibly it was my first open remarks that I disagree with this statement. And it appeared that the crisis hit Russian economy very severely, because of the self-orientation for the raw material industry, firstly, absence of the diversification of the economy, secondly, and thirdly, you know, with all these disproportions occurred during the period of restructuring, not only of political system, but economical system either, you know, everything was not already placed to meet the demands. So from the angle of the railway CEO, I can tell you that from the beginning we focused on the needs to improve infrastructural situation in Russia. And we were not alone. Look, you know, China spent more than $500 billion to improve infrastructure. They became the second biggest infrastructure railway company in the world. So they overcome us. We have 85,300 kilometers. They have now 10,000 kilometers more than us. Okay, nevertheless, during the period of 2003 up to 2008, the economy was developing quite goodly in Russia. You know the figures. But of course, the crisis, you know, decreased the development of the economy greatly. That was the position of Mr. Putin as a prime minister, that the infrastructural project could and should persist. So the government decided to support the infrastructure development in Russia, but they decided to keep the rise of the tariffs. It was the first time in the history of Russian economy, of modern time, that the government decided to subsidize infrastructural projects of Russian railways, first time through all the period. And it was not known in, say, Europe. They have this mechanism, in Russia never. So that reflects the attitude on the part of the government towards the development of infrastructure, which is absolutely essential to develop the economy as a whole. Secondly, the social aspect. From the beginning, you know, the government targeted to keep the social security of the people in Russia at the level they promised. Economically speaking, I don't think that is economically wise or proven attempt, but socially speaking, it was absolutely necessary. Due to this, we came through this crisis, at least up to now, you know, more or less stable. More or less, why? Because, say, in Kaliningrad we had some disturbances, in Far East we had some disturbances, but that cannot be compared with the disturbances in Greece. Not of the scale at all. So this is very essential. And, you know, being the head of a railway company, which employs 1.2 million employees, you know, I was summoned one day to the White House in Moscow, and there was a discussion what could happen. And I said, listen, due to the economical situation, I should fire 1,070 with something, 100 personnel. And the answer was, please, Mr. Yakunin, can you do anything but to keep people on work? We don't need people ousted to the streets. And then, you know, we addressed the above the trade union, we addressed the employees directly. I invited the representatives to come to Moscow. And it was decided that people agreed to go on part-time job instead of being fired at all. And we came through this crisis without any disturbances in the big company, 1.2 million personnel. You can understand what does it mean. So that is the brief answer and brief overview of the past, what we are having now. You know, judging by the balances of Russian railways, compared to the last year, we have the rise above, you know, like 15%. But compared to 2008, we still under the, you know, the figure, 16%. So you can judge, we lost nearly 30% of the operations in 2000, during the crisis of 2009. It was nearly same in Europe, and recovery in Russia is going maybe better. Why? Because we have, you know, we have the cargo. We are producing the cargo. And because of that, we are getting a little bit maybe better. But we do not have that kind of support on the part of the governments. And that is another problem.
Now, the Russian Rails has been known as a company that's always operated through world wars, through the revolution. It's an institution that's one of the unique institutions. It's weathered the crisis quite well. But Russia as a whole, among all the BRIC countries, was the only country that had a severe drop in GDP. You've been critical about some of the actions that were taken during the beginning of the crisis. What would you have done differently now in hindsight, and what at the time did you think should have been done?
Absolutely correct. Among Greek countries, we are the only country with the negative balance. We lost 7.9% of the GDP, you know, and you know, even Brazil has some positive result through the crisis. In my opinion, and I was constantly trying to reach the government and to explain, I was of the opinion that in such periods we need to concentrate to invest rather heavily into development of infrastructure. Because without infrastructure, all words about diversification of the economy couldn't be proved true. Unfortunately, I succeeded only partially. On one side, we got the support on the, from the government. We got subsidies. We are getting monies to develop Olympic objects in Sochi. We are doing quite well. But on the same time, we lost 40% of the investment budget compared to 2008. And this is not good. You know, it is difficult to say if I were, because you are who you are. But I insisted, and I insist now, instead of buying, you know, some bonds of the American government, we'd better, you know, invest into the development of our own infrastructure, like it was done, say, in China, for example, or in Italy, or in Spain. Everywhere in the world. So my opinion is still my opinion. Who is the right person, you know, the history will show.
Mm-hmm. President Medvedev has talked a lot about the innovation economy and diversifying Russia away from natural resources as the anchor of the economy. How realistic is that? And how long do you think it'll take to achieve that goal?
On one hand, it is absolutely realistic because Mr. Medvedev was not the one who invented the formula of modernization. I will live in Washington. I already, told that firstly, the words of modernization were pronounced by Mr. Brezhnev, to tell the truth. You know, but in Russia, this sentiment, this feeling, and that target of modernization was always among the most critical targets any government had. Maybe Mr. Medvedev is the only one in newest history of Russia who declared it so completely and made this his basis for further political development of his platform. It is realistic because it is absolutely essential and necessary, you know, to achieve. It is difficult to achieve because we are in crisis and because, the previous period destroyed a lot such kind of institutions like science and technology research. Destroyed, once best in the world educational system, destroyed healthcare system. Many things were destroyed in the course of what you name perestroika, and we named it perestroika. And, you know, to restore this, that is difficult. It is impossible, you know, just invent something and then to find the place how to implement this idea into the real economical or scientifical products, because the technology appeared to be obsolete. And, you know, to restore the level of the technology to accept these innovative programs, we need to do a lot with education, with professionalism of the people. We need to do a lot, you know, to return our scientists who are working everywhere. You know, I visited Singapore. You know, Russian scientists, they are rising Singapore research centers everywhere. You know, we were talking with my friend, and he said, listen, Russians all over the places. You know, when I was young, I never saw that many Russians. So
there are 30,000.
Well,
more than 30,000 Russian professionals, speaking professionals, working in Silicon Valley.
Yes, but you know, in say in London, they have 250,000 Russians. So you know, we need to.
They're not the engineers, though. That are in London.
not all of them.
They make more money.
Not all of them, of course. So that is the challenge, and of course, you know, only if the society is united around this idea, it can be achieved.
What's the view from Russia on pushing the reset button, the перезагрузка, in the United States?
Listen, sometimes we say this is a slip of the tongue by freight, if you know what I mean. Because they firstly said, they used reset instead of other word, yes. So I suppose on both sides, there is a great deal of political will to restore the relations, normal relations. You know, to stop looking at each other with only one purpose. If it is good for you, it should be blocked, because it will be bad for me, and vice versa. In Washington, I was asked the question, listen, to be the partners, you know, two sides should value the same human values. Only then they can be partners. Do you think that Russia will achieve the level to be the partner to the United States? And I answered, listen, business speaking language means if we are partners, we have the common targets, mutually accepted. It doesn't mean that we should be alike. But if we are talking about real friendship, Russian understanding or English language understanding, this is another story. And then we should consider, you know, both ways traffic, where the Russians are you know, mature enough to value the same things like Americans or Brits or, you know, Chinese or whatsoever. We are different. But if we are different, that does not mean that we are enemies. And that is the paradigm of world public or public forum dialogue of civilization. So that is the answer.
How about Russia-EU relations? the events in Greece, new government in the UK, local election upset with Angela Merkel's party.
Yeah.
How does this affect Russia's interests in Europe?
You know, last year I was invited to participate in a global business council, you know, summoned by 80 Kearney company, you possibly know this. And there was a question about the global competitiveness of Europe. And then I asked the question, when you are talking about global competitiveness, you need to answer the question, against whom and for what? And there was a moment of silence, and then I continued. The only real competitor of the EU economy isn't Russia. It is even not China. Of course, not Africa, Latin America. Then who? You know, they are competing with your economy. That is only, you know, the, objectively speaking, the only economy to compete. So if we are talking about EU interests, at the same time, not forgetting about Russian interests, I suppose that more close cooperation, if not integration, between Russia and EU can bring a very serious actor, economical-wise, you know, socially-wise, and political-wise. Not to fight with other economies or other political systems, but I am answering the question, what are the relations between Russia and EU? This is my personal opinion, that greater cooperation between Russia and EU can bring much more positive effects than all this, you know, talks about, you know, strategic influence of Russia due to the fact of energy resources or so ever.
Let me go back to reset. U.S.-Russia cooperation on transit to Afghanistan. What is the effect of the recent events and upheaval in Kyrgyzstan on the transit route into Afghanistan, given the important role that Russian railways plays?
Just for the record, when firstly the idea occurred about the supply of the troops in Afghanistan, we were persistent to state that that is a good way to show actual restart of the relations between Russia and the United States of America and European countries. You know, we consider differently the situation in Afghanistan. Just mind that the narcotic traffic rised during this period in Afghanistan 44 times. You know, we have nothing to be happy about this, not in America, not in Russia, and anywhere. But still, we continue this operation. And even the turmoil in Kyrgyzstan did not stop the traffic. You know, besides my position as a president of Russian Railways, I am a chairman of the Railways Union of CIS countries, Baltic Republics, etc. So this is our strategy. Whatever is happening on the political level, the transit operations of railways should not be disturbed. And, you know, you see, we try to keep this like real life operations.
There was a lot of anger recently about the elections in Moscow. you've been very critical about it. Can you tell us your thoughts on that? Also, do you believe the political system in Russia fundamentally needs to be changed or liberalized?
I have an expert here. He's sitting right on the right side, you know, and you can, you know, tackle him a little bit later very strongly. He can explain everything about the political system because he is practical, practitioner, or practicing politician. I'm not. But speaking about the development of new political system, this is the right word, new political system. Ladies and gentlemen, just imagine, 20 years ago, there was Soviet Union, which is a system which was developing for 70 years. You know, people were brought up in this system. I was brought up in this system. My sons, they were brought up in this system. So it was a complete collapse of all the values then, you know, society had. And to introduce new system, new institutional reforms, both political, legal, etc., it needs time. Yes, we were angry with everything which occurred in Moscow, and you know that possibly were the first time when the president of Russian Federation met with the oppositional leaders to express his own opinion about that. And when you know Mr. Medvedev is talking about legal society, law enforcement instruments, he is talking openly and he is talking frankly. So that is true. Yes, we need time to change the system, to improve the society. But, you know, the most difficult part in all reforms, that are the reforms in the heads, in the brains of the people, not in the railways, not even in the political institution, in the brains.
Russian democracy. What, in your opinion, is the state of democracy in Russia?
Listen, this is always questionable because when we're using the same words, sometimes we understand differently the meaning of the words. The brilliant example is the word friendship, meaning in Russian, and friendship, meaning in English. Same possibly can be, the same can be applied to the understanding of the state of democracy. Listen, say it was 1978 when a special lecture from the regional party committee discussed with the young people the matters of social political status in then Soviet Union. And he told the audience, I remember these words very well, if the party and the government would not take the efforts, in 10 years, Soviet Union would face a major political and socio-economical crisis. We need to change social-political system. That was a representative of the party talking to young people. At that time, all the fighters for the freedom in the Soviet Union, they just did not know even the words of this type. So could it be named democracy at that time? Possibly yes. But at that time, the understanding of democracy was completely different. Nowadays, I suppose the situation in Russia changed greatly. You who visited Moscow, who visited St. Petersburg, you can observe it with your own eyes. But can we say that the society is happy? I don't think so. I don't think so. Because in every society, the understanding of democracy is going along with the understanding of the self-esteem of the people, if you know what I mean. If they don't have food to feed their kids, they don't care about the, you know, their human values because they need to feed people. And trust me, in Russia we can have, we can find this kind of, you know, villages, not even just the families, villages we can find. On the same time, the development of the parliament, the development of the electoral system, the development of communications between the government and society, between the government and business, those are the features of the democratic society. So the answer is complex and difficult. You know, I cannot say, you Americans, you come to Russia, you will see a completely, you know, refurbished democratic society. That won't be true. But at the same time, I would say, you come to Russia, you see a new society with new people who are wishing to achieve better life, who are wishing to achieve better status. And for Russians, it's very essential that they would like to see their state also, you know, respectful state. This is very essential. We still have this kind of sentiments. Doesn't matter, you know, elderly persons or young persons, if they think, they will tell the same.
Thank you. We have time to take questions now from the floor, so I'd ask if you could state your name and your affiliation, please. A microphone will be coming your way if you raise your hand in the back.
Hi, thank you. My name is Riva Freimovich. I'm a reporter for Dow Jones. I wanted to ask you about capital raising plans.
About?
Capital raising plans.
Capital.
for Russian Railways. I know that you recently issued a bond. I believe there are plans to issue more this year, and there are plans for IPO. Just wondering about the timing and the size.
I see. Listen, we are quite new company in this field, but I'm proud to state that our debut issue of the bonds in London was quite successful, and we got the demand 50% higher in terms of monies than we were planned to do. So we agreed with the board of directors even to raise additional $500 million of the bonds. And we got very, very good interest rate for that. Previously, we were taking credits from financial institutions in the West because we have investment rating equal to the sovereign status, and that is just the reflection of the status of the reformation of Russian railways. As far as IPOs are concerned, we are not planning to privatize Russian railways as the holding, but we have 150 daughter companies. And we already have partially privatized company Transcontainer. We are going to go public with first freight company, cargo company. We are going to introduce to the market some other daughter companies, and that will be our way of getting additional funds from the market, I suppose, for the period of coming 2 years. Our idea is that we are going to get from the market, to get from the private sources, quite a substantial sum of monies to develop infrastructural projects of Russian railways. As far as IPOs for Energy Day, as it is, I suppose it is a little bit premature to talk about this because of the crisis. We postpone the entire development of reforms a little bit. We need the restoration of the market. I'm not going to sell cheap what is actually valuable assets. And that is our attitude. Thank you.
Peter?
The development of the United States in the 19th century, particularly the West, was really a function of the development of the railroads. The Russian Far East, undeveloped. What are your plans over the next 5 years to develop the Russian Far East?
We were the first company to introduce a strategic plan for development of Russian railways up to 2030. We were the only and the first organization in Russia recently to introduce this plan, and this plan was accepted by the government and became the governmental document, if you know what I mean. Now, you hardly can find any institution in Russia that doesn't have a plan at least for 5 or 20 years. So our plan to develop Far East consists of, in terms of Russian railways, of course, consists of the need to develop infrastructure just to give the access to the distant areas where the major raw material sites are existing. Secondly, we should develop the passenger operations because now some of the regions of Russia, they have no any means of transport communication at all. So recently, Prime Minister called me and he advised me to reconsider the plan to address the need of development of high-speed programs for Far East region and Siberia region. So it will be our plan to develop this communication means of transportation between major cities of Siberia and Far East. That is first. Secondly, we are going to develop so-called project of Ural Industrial Ural Pola. And several days ago, we had a session with the presidential representative, Mr. Venichenko, discussing this matter together with some major companies in the field of oil production and coal production, etc. So that will be the biggest enterprise, the biggest program in my mind for the last 25 years total. So that will be the second. We need to improve communication in the areas of Yakutia, and that is a very severe area where the temperature can drop below 40, 50 degrees, and still Russian railways, they are operating at these temperatures, so that will be the third. And then we also have to develop not already Russian railways, but we have investment fund, and through this investment fund, we are going to invest into development of some infrastructural projects which are interested from the point of view of the development of raw material industries and with the period of return much longer than, say, 15 years. So that's more or less, the answer to your question because it needs much more time. Thank you.
China and Russia and exploration of possible areas of cooperation, collaboration, economic development, economic infrastructure development, investment between the two. And related to that, your concerns about the debt crisis in Europe as well as the United States issues related to both.
Yeah. Very interesting question. And I have so many things to answer, but I just concentrate on one thing. Firstly, the cooperation between Russia and China does not mean the cooperation against somebody. That is finished. In the 70s, when the Soviet Union was fighting in Afghanistan, your friend was organizing the delivery of the Chinese weaponry to Afghanistan to fight with the Soviet troops. Those years, they passed. But on the other hand, that is possibly another angle of the view on the issue. Recently, I considered the forecast for the development of the economies up to 2050. And the first three economies, they were arranged like this: China, United States, India, a little bit with a big drop, then Russia, then Brazil, United Kingdom, etc. The question is, are the industrial elite of the United States of America and Europe will stand idle waiting till the Chinese economy will go higher? Because the higher economy, the more politically influential is the state. So the answer for this forecast is not obvious. If everything will develop like that, that will be true. But then suddenly, you know, volcano erupted somewhere and the entire world, you know, appeared to be too fragile. So I don't believe that the industrialized countries, the big eight, will just still wait what is going on in China and when the China will have upper hand above the economies of entire world. So speaking about cooperation between Russia and China, we are in the same position. I don't think we just should wait till China became the most powerful economically state. We need to develop that kind of cooperation which can increase the ability for the Russian economy to develop at the same time like Chinese economy. I am not, you know, leveling the economies of two countries, but I suppose that can be the attitude. Thank you.
Ted.
The issue of corruption in the Russian economy continues to be of great concern to the international investment community. Most recently, there was a lot of concern expressed not only about the two major wireless licenses that have been handed out, one to Yota, which seemed to have been done surreptitiously, and then the second, there was supposed to be an open tender, and yet Rostelecom and Shiraz Invest wind up with 100% of the licenses that were granted. And the latter seemed to violate some of the very rules of the tender. So and that simply underscores the continued concern that the elites continue to gather the key assets for themselves and erode the ability of third parties to come in and compete. And I wonder what your observations are on these and why it is, if at all, people should think more positively about the investment climate there.
Not easy answer for this question. You know, the history of corruption did not start in Russia and possibly will not finish in Russia. And in different aspects, we observe this reflection of human being nature in many countries, in the United States either. All these scandals concerning the derivatives, which are, you know, boiling out now in the professional society in the West, just shows that also is the case. But when we are talking about the corruption as a whole in Russia, of course we need to understand that where is the shortage of something, there is some ways how to overcome this. This is not the mental problem of the society. This is not the problem of the civil servant only. That is the problem. This is the, you know, society disease, if you wish. And when the foreign investor is seeking the possibility to work in some countries, my personal advice is, firstly, find a proper partner. You know, when I advise my growing up kids, I have two boys. You know, sometimes I joked, if you would like to know who will be your wife in 20 years, make acquaintance with the prospective mother-in-law. Same with the business. If you would like to see what will be your business, firstly, to find and get acquainted with a proper partner in the country. This is not easy question, but that is question, the question which is openly stated in the society and in the government. It is stated by the President of Russian Federation, and I suppose that the society should get rid of this disease. You know, I know many entrepreneurs from the West. Some of them started operations in Russia at the beginning of Perestroika, 1991. They came through two major crises. They will never leave country. Why? Because they are successful, they are quite profitable, and they don't want change places. They are living in the environment of Russian Federation. And when Pepsi-Cola was sued for the bribes in Russia many years ago, that was Pepsi-Cola who bribed the authorities of the Soviet Union. When, you know, the head of the biggest company, Siemens, stepped down, that was not due to the fact that he was bad, but because the, you know, American auditors, in the amount of 500, they were digging through the, you know, materials, through the balance sheet of this company, finding where they were bribing authorities somewhere in different countries. So I suppose all of us, we need to be honest to answer the question whether we are doing everything to fight the corruption. But the major question is correctly directed to Russians, because that is our country and we are responsible for everything which is going on there. If you need partner, come.
We have time for one or two more questions before a hard stop at 8 o'clock.
Hi, it's Mahmoud Mamdani from Morgan Stanley. I'm curious, you talked about the innovation economy as being a critical thing to get right to help get the Russian economy and the people onto the right track in terms of economic development. That sounds a lot like the U.S. plan. You know, we need to do the same thing as all our manufacturing jobs have shifted away. So do you see some areas of cooperation where we can work together, since innovation is something that's quite a hallmark in the U.S., and how we might cooperate to help each other get through this in a similar model?
I suppose the cooperation between two societies, two governments, Russian and American, has a very, very great opportunity. Firstly, mentally and naturally, we are very much alike. You are a multinational country, we are a multinational country. You have all the possible religions in your country, we have the same. You are big, and we are big. And besides the scientific schools, they were developing alongside, competing with each other. You know, not only observing, but getting from the other side a lot, like Americans from Russians and like Russians from Americans. So even now, for example, in my field already, a new plant was constructed in Leningrad district in the city of Tikhvin, and this is 100% American technology to be brought to the Russian soil to produce rolling stocks in Russia. First time, I suppose, since the beginning of the Soviet era. We have a lot, you know, in common to cooperate in the airspace field. Mr. Atkov, my deputy, he is an astronaut. He spent 8 months in the outer space. He knows that quite better than myself, and he can explain this. And besides, I suppose, the fact that we found absolutely essential to be together to control the distribution of weapons of mass destruction, to control nuclear energy production, and to find the new sources of not only energy, but otherwise, I suppose that is a great platform to cooperate. And by the way, Morgan Stanley is well aware about the possibilities in Russia, and I suppose we are going along.
One last question.
Estonian TV. Our president went for the first time to the 9th of May to Russia, and suddenly there is a warming about Estonia and Russia, Latvia, Lithuania and Russia. A few years ago, Estonia was one of the enemies of Russia. Do you think there is a difference now with the neighbors of Russia? You said the railway system will continue developing despite everything.
Yes, I answer, but may I ask you a question as Estonian to Estonian? Do you speak Russian or not? Are you native?
Говорю по-русски.
Okay. Listen, it is not true to say that the Estonians were enemies of Russians. But there are some touchy points which we need to understand. Just imagine in the United States of America, somebody insulted, kidnapped the citizen of the United States of America. The entire Sixth Fleet will go to the place. And I suppose this is right. This is right. The state should defend the interests of the citizens of this country. We were at the beginning of the ceremonies of the great victory. Now it is 65th anniversary. Before that it was 1 year younger. At that period of time, the Prime Minister of Estonia declared that the monument to the soldiers killed during the World War II should be demolished and replaced. The result was absolutely, absolutely obvious. And they got what they planned to get. There is no enemies like Russians and Estonians. Our mutual enemies are fools. And even more, if they are political fools, it's even more dangerous. And you know, the fact that the relation between Russia and Baltic republics is getting better, that is not only that the president visited Moscow during the parade. He visited our conference, railway conference, 2 months prior to these things, and I was surprised. The president, you know, came to the regional conference of railways, and he stated quite obvious signals, and those signals were delivered to Russia. With, say, Lithuanians, we have a lot to work together. In Latvia, we also have common interests. So, you know, that was due to the political miscalculations that we were getting apart. Maybe with some outside influence, but, you know, the fact is, you know, we have all the possibilities of improvement of the relations. And the Baltic republics, they more greatly tied to the Russian economy than even other republics of the former Soviet Union.
On that note, thank you, Mr. Yakunin, very much.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.